Right, well, what I'm going to do today is sort of two parts to this presentation. I'm going to give an overview of the sort of history and development of the various local authority bodies. There should be a handout on your sheet there which does list the records that are held. So there's a wonderful diversity of bodies which have been involved with the local administration of Belfast over the last 400 years. So I'm going to run over how that develops and then I'll focus in on what is the main archive. The old Belfast Corporation Archive, which is referred to as LA7, which runs through to 1973. It's interesting that we're now doing this talk as part of this series on surviving the city, tying into the series which are the project which Queens have, looking at poverty and public health in Belfast in the 19th and 20th centuries. My involvement with local authority records and archives goes back to 1998 or 1999, where I was involved in a project funded by the Heritage Lottery Fund to catalogue and move in the PRONI, the records of the Belfast City Council out of the old City Hall basements. And at that stage, when I was working on that, dutifully tried to read up on the history of the council and the rest of it, and found there was actually very little written about Belfast council as itself, as an institution, the actual institution of local government. There was Budge and O'Leary's, it's called Ian Montgomery, or O'Leary's book, Belfast Approach to Crisis, which had started off as a study of Belfast City Council in the 1960s, which they sort of redeveloped very quickly when the Troubles broke out as a book which would explain how the Troubles arrived in Belfast, which it doesn't do particularly well, but it does give you a reasonable overview of the history of Belfast City Council to that date. But it just emphasised how little there was had been written on it. This is not the case now, and hopefully the work which we did in the City Hall, along with, I was working there with Robert Corbett, who's now the records manager in Belfast City Hall, has actually brought a lot of those records out and made it available. So there's been a lot of research has been done the last few years. It was actually focused on the role of the council and the other administrative bodies in the development of the city. And there's two or three PhDs actually going on at the minute. One of Stuart Irwin will be talking this later on. And there's been a couple of publications, the Belfast 400 book out by Sean Conway. A lot of, you know, the record, the actual council record, he used quite a lot in it. So there has been a lot more now written about the institutions, but there is a lot more to be done. So part of the purpose of this talk presentation is actually to explain what is out there for anybody wants to do any further research. So with Belfast, the starting point usually for the Civic Archive is 1613 in the Belfast Charter. If you were around a couple of years ago, there was all these charter celebrations. 2013 was the charter years. There's about 40 towns and cities in Belfast, in Ireland, which got charters in that year. There was a sort of temporary outbreak of interest in civic history. It could drown a lot of the other anniversaries, but it made a change from all the 100th anniversaries. We're doing 400th anniversaries of the charter. However, it's worth pointing out, recent research has emphasised the fact that Belfast itself is a lot older than 400 years. There is evidence of human habitation in the Belfast area for about 8,000 years, and probably some sort of settlement on the site for 800 years. They've had an increase in budget and they've actually bought a new laser pointer, but I probably not know how to work it. I can now share this at airplanes coming out of the airport. So Belfast site is quite known. The important physical reason for Belfast is where it is the ford. That is one of the few places where it's possible to cross the Lagan. So it was quite possible to cross the Lagan in ancient times. And you have this sort of small area of higher land between Blackstaff and the Forest Rivers. The horse is still there running along, it's now High Street. Blackstaff has been realigned several times, but it did come out there, it's now Victoria Square. And you have this little area of higher ground, which sort of controlled the ford. And you have a castle there from the Middle Ages, and a chapel, which is down where St. George's is now. And you also have two or three important roads. You have the road up through Hollywood, up through County Down, crossing the Lagmuir, as I said. You have another road coming up from Lisburn direction along the Lagan Valley, along the Malone Ridge, which is a ridge of high ground. It's rather than you go up onto the Malone Road. So that Malone Ridge is a very important routeway up into, coming up towards the ford. And you have two routes going north, one along the shore towards Carrickfergus, and one along the Shankill Road going out the Antrim. So it's an important junction of these roadways from very early times. You say there's a castle there, medieval castle. The Normans put a castle there. The Bruces, Scots burnt it down in the 14th century. Rebuilt, the O'Neills then move in during the 15th century, and they become important there. How much of a town there was there is still a matter of some debate, but there's definitely some sort of settlement. So when Chichester comes along in 1603, he's not sort of moving on to a blank site. There's certainly a settlement there. There is, however, no records, as far as I'm aware, of the settlement, so there's no archival heritage there. So the archive starts with 1613, with the foundation by Arthur Chichester of the settlement here. One of a number of settlements, he was also constable of Carrickfergus Castle. Belfast was certainly secondary to Carrickfergus there, but he wanted to secure the site and he wanted to develop his own town. Brings in settlers, England, Scotland, and Ireland. The charter is granted in 1613. The charter itself, 1613 charters, are a short-term political manoeuvre. It was to give these new settlers, new plantation settlers, a voice in the Irish Parliament, because the Irish Parliament was comprised of representatives of the counties, but mainly of representatives from the boroughs, the incorporated boroughs, who sent two MPs. So it was to give, basically, these guys representation in the Parliament. So that's why the charters are granted in 1613. There are a wide number of towns, including Belfast. Some of these towns probably didn't actually exist, or the only sort of ideas. Charlemont in County Tyrone is one which actually didn't develop, but it does get a charter. And a small town does develop. By 1645, there were a population probably in the region of 1,000. By the end of the century, you have a population of about 5,000. So it does develop into a reasonably important market town. The charter set up a corporation to run the town, and these charters were more or less a standard format for all of the towns. The main idea of the charter was to set up a structure, but to make sure that power remained with the landlord, in this case Chichester. So you have a lord of the castle of Belfast, which is Chichester. He appoints a constable of the castle of Belfast, and that guy is usually his agent in the area. Then you have a sovereign and burgesses. There's 13 burgesses, and they elect one of the numbers of sovereign, which basically means the mayor. That's a self-perpetuating oligarchy. It basically means that the original charter named the 13 original burgesses. Any other vacancies are then filled by the burgesses themselves. They nominate their own replacements with the approval of the lord of the castle. So that's a closed circle, as it were. Then you have the freemen of the town. Now, there's been some debate in recent years about what role the freemen actually had in the actual administration of the town. The freeman is anybody that was free of the town, anybody that was able to live and trade in the town. Some of these boroughs, there's evidence that the freemen actually took part in the governing. It's a wee bit more important in Belfast. There are mentions of meetings, public meetings, where possibly the freemen did sort of meet and at least express an opinion about what they wanted to happen. But generally the power, the actual administrative authority, stayed very much with the burgesses and actually with Chichester and the Chichester family. Now the records of this early corporation are pretty easily available. Most of them are in what's called the Town Book of Belfast. There was one volume of proceedings of the corporation. It was edited by R.M. Young and printed at the start of the 20th century. Reprinted again a few years ago, so it is available in paperback with an introduction by Ray Gillespie, I think. So it's reasonably easy to access. The original of it is still in the hands of the Chichester family, but there is a microfilm copy of the original in here if you do want to go back to the original. So this is taken from the printed version. There, and you know, there's one volume covering basically 150 years. There's not a great deal going on. They're meeting, you usually get a couple of meetings per year. Their main job is they elect the two MPs. That's the important thing, two MPs to the Parliament. The rest, they sort of have episodic bits where they take an interest in actually doing things in the town. So for instance, that page there, this is a sentence in the Assembly which suggests that there was some meeting. It does say the Burgess and the Commonality met to discuss various things, and this was they actually developed at the harbour. Belfast developed as a training town, and so you see them discussing the need for new quays and developing the harbour facilities with the counter dowagers of Donegal and Lady Anne Chichester, the Chichester family. So they are deciding between them what to do for the town. So it's being done more or less in partnership with the family and the Burgesses and the leading families. And that's the names there of the Burgesses, and you know, a lot of these are going are leading merchants in the town. George McCartney, Lucas, these guys, they're actually involved in trading the town, they're important merchants. Other things they're doing, I mean, that's petition of the tailors in the town. This is quite interesting. This is the tailors and the freemen in the town. They're getting together to try and stop people from outside the town coming in and trading. So the tailors are saying that they should have a monopoly of trade in the town. That's, I think, this was 1645, I think, depending on it. So that's, you know, an example of what the corporation will be doing, is trying to restrict access to trade to people who are freemen. And they actually say, there, we're free in the town, we pay rates of taxes in the town, we don't want anybody from outside coming in. The problem is, it's not only that they're going away in Belfast, you know, the street traders in Belfast, and shopkeepers in Belfast are still saying the same sort of thing 100 years later. And an example of, you know, the Chichester actually doing some public health work. So you might say they're complaining about the danger from malt columns in the town and ordering restrictions on them. So there's a lot of what we would now call building control going on, where they're trying to restrict what's being built in the town. There's another one where they're talking about pollution, butchers dropping throwing the offal into the rivers and polluting them. It's probably worse than the offal going into those rivers, but there's an attempt actually at some sort of public health provision. So that's an example of, you know, of the old corporation and the landlord working together. And just one last one, because this is poverty orientated series of talks, I thought I'd put this in. Again, this is a part of Assembly, so this is a joint meeting of the Burgesses with some representatives of Commonality. And it talks about the poor's money. And what this is that the Earl of Donegal and various other people, when they died, they left money in their wills to look after the poor of the town. So this fund had been established called the Poor's Money, and this discussing that this money should be invested and used to help poor people in the town. But they're very, if you read through it, they're talking about the good of the decayed inhabitants of this corporation. They're very keen that this charity is restricted to people who actually live in the town. And it says there are all the inmates and beggars who come in or secretly convey themselves to the town, which may be diligently sought after and a speedy course taken to discharge the town as such. But basically, this money is for people in the town. Anybody who comes in from the outside and comes into the town to beg is going to be shifted out again. And again, this is a theme you see right the way through the 18th and 19th century when you're looking at poverty. There's people saying, charity, yes, it's fine, but the charity is for our own people. We don't encourage people to come into the town looking for charity. And they're talking about looking after orphans. There are orphan children left in the town, you know, if there's a child in town, there's no parents, nobody has to look after it. The town is to take responsibility for it, to be sent as apprentices to masses in the towns. So that's just an idea of what they're doing. This poor fund comes back again. The idea is that the corporation is to look after this money and invest it. It's not really a good idea, just leaving the council to get on with it like this, because when there's an inquiry in 1830, about this fund, nobody traced any of it. It just disappeared down through the years. It is actually being paid out for a while. There's lists of the poor there. I should say there's a second volume of records of this old corporation. Most of it is records of this time book, which is printed. There's a second volume here which isn't printed, which is available in here, called the Assembly Book, which is the continuation of the original book. And that's where this is from. And this is lists of the poor for people in town who have been given alms from this poor fund. So you do get to actually sort some names of these people. A little bit of background to it. As I said, originally the corporation isn't doing very much, but it's doing some work towards the actual administration of the town in cooperation with the family. There's a sort of falling out towards the end of the century with the family. The majority of the population in Belfast is Presbyterian and of Scottish origin. The Chichesters are actually are in the Church of England and part of the establishment. There's a certain tension there. Also, towards the end of the century, the Irish Parliament brings in penal laws to try and restrict government offices to members of the established Church of Ireland. And they also exclude Catholics and they also exclude Presbyterians. They want to exclude Presbyterians from any office, any government office, or any position where they would have any influence. And there's a row in the town towards the end of the 19th century between some of the leading merchants who are starting to exert their own sort of independence and the Chichester family. There's a row over an election where Burgesses decide they want to elect their own MP. They have an idea of who they want to be the MP. Chichester is very much against them, having said that he wants them to. He's certainly just elect the person he tells him to. There is a bit of a row, and at the end, the Chichester family invoke the penal laws, and they basically have the Presbyterians removed from the corporation. The Presbyterians are left where they have to take the oath test act. They have to use a test act, which basically means they have to prove that they're communicant members of the Church of Ireland. If they don't do that, they can't hold office. So the fallout from that is that most of the Presbyterians leave the corporation. They're replaced by nominees, but that takes out basically your most active and your most prosperous citizens from the town out of the corporation. So long term, it does damage the corporation. The corporation then becomes made up of people who don't have a major role in the town. So it does decline in influence during the 18th century, and really by the middle of the 18th century, it's a largely ceremonial body. It is the only thing it's really doing is the actual elections of two MPs. Occasionally you will get them doing other things. For instance, occasionally you get outbreaks of sort of populist politics showing up in the corporation record, which is the Assembly Book. This is a petition in 1781. This is when you're getting into the era of reform towards the end of the 18th century. Basically, there's a town meeting of other citizens when they say they wanted their MPs to do various things, to vote in certain ways in the Irish Parliament, and this is what this is about, and this is recorded in the town book because it's an important public event. As it happens, the two MPs tell them where to go. They're not there to answer the people in the town, they're there to answer the landlords, so it doesn't really go anywhere. But you do get an interesting list of some of the names of people and families in the town at that period. So there's Mateers, for instance, for quite well-known names, McCabe, Thomas McCabe. He's an interesting figure, Valentine Jones. So if you've done any of the history of the 18th century in Belfast, you'll know some of these names. There's an orator as well, Daniel Blow. These are all quite well-known figures, Hart Harper from Montgomery. So these are Odell Cunningham, another well-known merchants. So at least you're getting their names down there. But the corporation itself, although it's just sort of recording these petitions, it is not really doing very much. And just by way of contrast, I'll just throw that in. The Declaration of Loyalty, 1826, is the citizens of Belfast declaring their loyalty to the Crown, which is just an interesting example of how times have changed in Belfast. So being a radical Presbyterian city before the 1798 Rebellion and Act Union, the 1826 is a very loyal town. You'll get the same surnames in here. You'll get Mateers, you'll get Montgomerys. You'll get the same people with the same name, but they're now very anxious to prove how loyal they are to the Crown and always have been. So it's just an interesting facet of it. The town develops and grows quite quickly during the 18th century. By the middle of the century, population of 8,500. By 1802, the Act of Union come in, its population of 19,000, and that's the town there in 1822. Hasn't developed much on the east side, on this side of the river, but certainly on the County Antrim side, it is very well developed. It's an important trading town. The docks there are problems with the docks, but they are usable up to a point, so it's become an important port town. Very important in the linen industry, not linen manufacturing at this stage, but the commercial side of linen, the actual business end of it, and the trading of linen, it's quite important. So as I said, it's one of the more important ports now. So it's one of the most important towns in Ireland by this stage. So the question is, who's actually running the town, given that the corporation is really, this corporation isn't doing that much? Well, the Donegal family are still around. They have a sort of, this is Arthur Chichester, he becomes the Earl of Donegal. The family then later become the Marquesses of Shaftesbury, which adds to the confusion of names. They have a sort of checkered history during the 19th century, or during the 18th century. They're absentees really from about the end of the 17th century. The castle, Belfast Castle, burns down and the family moves over to England where they have an estate. Then you have one of the earls who's incapable, as politely said, during most of the century. That's the fourth earl. The fifth earl is more active, and he does come back to the town a bit, and he does spend some money. He builds the assembly rooms, he gives the land for what becomes the poor house, we'll talk about in a minute. Gives the land for the White Linen Hall, which later becomes the City Hall, and he finances the like a navigation, the like a canal, so he's very active. He does actually, though, bankrupt himself in various things. He doesn't bankrupt himself for getting money to Belfast, should he say, but he bankrupts himself in other ways. The family becomes that poor that the second Marquess is reduced to actually living in Belfast because he can't afford to live anywhere else, and most of his creditors are in England, so he decides to come to Belfast to get away from them. So he's actually resident in the town from 1902, and sort of is more of a presence in the town. But as I said, he's very short of money, and from the 1820s onwards, in order to raise money, he's having to give perpetual leases. The Donegals still own the actual town, but he's having to give very, very long perpetual leases at this stage. To raise money, what you do, instead of giving a short lease for 20 or 30 years, you give a lease for 100 years and you get a big payment up front. So they were doing that in order, because he was so short of cash. But that's a bad thing in the long term, because you basically lose control of the land when it's given out in a 100-year lease or something like that. You're really losing control. So these long-term perpetual leases, although they bring some cash in, are actually bad for the family. And in the end, they have to sell off the remainder of their interest in 1849 on the Encumbered Estates Act. Having said which, they still don't feel simple, if you know the sort of legal definition, although they're not active landlords, they're still getting head rents from mostly Belfast. The Shaftesbury Street is still around, still has offices in Belfast, so they're still getting some income out of the time, but they're not getting very much at this stage. Even though they're still sort of bankrupt, they're still throwing money around. It's a great thing with the 18th, 19th century Irish aristocracy is they could have absolutely no money and be bankrupt and still spend money. They don't quite work out how they do it, but they manage it somehow. He does build himself a really nice house in what's now Arbor Park, Arbor House. So he is actually living in the town, and he is present in the town, and his family is very involved in the town. He marries a lady called May and the May family. That's a name you'll Streets, Mays Market, May Street, the May family become very active, not particularly well liked, it should be said, very active around the town. So there he is still, so the Donegal family, not a lot about it, is still actually a presence in the 18th and 19th century, so they still have some influence to a certain extent on the town up to a point. There are other bodies which are involved in the administration of the town. They're harder to actually find any record of. There is something called the court leet. There is a manorial court, and that's a long subject to talk for another day, the manorial court work, but there is a manorial, there's a manor of Belfast, there's a manorial court leet, and it is occasionally active in the 18th century. There don't appear, I never actually found any records of it as such, but you'll occasionally see it turning up in the newsletter, doing things. So there's a court leet, for instance, being held in 1782. Part of the problem is the great number of pigs running through the streets of the town, and this is public nuisance, and contrary to the Express Act of Parliament, so I'm not quite sure what Parliament, Act of Parliament outlawed pigs, but anyway, and resolved, so they decided that if any pigs are found running at large through this town from and after the 26th day of this month, they shall be destroyed, we having appointing proper persons for this purpose. So they appointed a pig killer. We did around Belfast and round up and kill any stray pigs. The guy that's running this is the central, you say, James Lewis. He would be actually the agent to Donegal. There's also the high constables there. Remember, the constable of Castle, so he's there as well. And there, mentioned the grand jury, that's a memorial grand jury. So that's a group of three local warriors who've got together as a memorial grand jury. So the court lead is basically operating. We don't know very, I haven't been able to trace very much evidence of activity. Occasionally you see things in the newsletter. As far as I can work out, it meets occasionally, and it does sort of things like that, deals with certain nuisances around the town. You also have a parish structure, you have a parish vestry. That is the parish of Belfast, which is Shankill, parish of Shankill. As you see, that's a town, the parish of Shankill takes up a much bigger area on the County Antrim side, and it is all on the County Antrim side. The county stuff across the river in East Belfast is in Upgrade Parish or Drumgold. Well, the County Antrim side is in Shankill Parish, and that's the extent of Shankill Parish there. There is a parish vestry, okay, which meets, and the parish vestry role at this stage is not just what a vestry does now, looking after the fabric of the church. It is involved with what we would call civil administration. It looks after the poor to a certain extent. It looks after orphan children and is responsible for road building. And they raise a tax called cess, actually, from things like that. So you do have a parish vestry for Belfast Parish, which is doing some stuff in the town. Again, I wasn't able to trace an early vestry, but you will get a case of notices, these are from the newsletter again, that a vestry has been held 16th of November. Unanimously agreed, Chris Stewart, the most effective methods, and they're talking about the problem of sweeping and carrying away the dirt, dung and filth off the streets and into the town of Belfast. So they agreed to divide the town in zones and to appoint people to actually clean the streets. So they're doing the basic work of actually getting the streets cleaned, organising dung hills, organising the dirt to be cleared off the streets and taken outside the town. And also another mention there about Vestry needing to received treasurer's accounts and expenses for the year for lighting and paving the town. So that's another function which the vestry is doing, organising the making of pavements and actually street lighting in the town. So they're doing things like that. Again, it's very hard to work out exactly what they're doing because the records are very episodic, so we're not quite sure how regularly they are doing this sort of thing. Another body which emerges in the 18th century is the Belfast Charitable Society. A lot of these wealthy Presbyterian merchants who don't get involved in the corporation anymore can get involved in these voluntary bodies, and the Belfast Charitable Society is set up as a voluntary body to organise sort of work to help the poor in the town. And it's formed in 1752. 1774 they go to the Irish Parliament, get an act of incorporation, gives them an official status. What they do is they build a poor house. Now, this is not to be confused with a later workhouse. This is an earlier example of poor house. It's the same idea that you help the poor by bringing them into somewhere where they can work, where you give them work. You don't give them alms, you give them work. So they set up a poor house where people could go to get work or to get relief. And they build the building which is still there, the poor house in Clifton Street. It's there to this day, and it's now Clifton House, and it's now a people's home. So you have this body set up doing that, and they get involved in a number of other projects, probably because there's an option for anybody else to do these things. They set up in 1795, they set up spring water commissioners, they established the first water supply into the town. Belfast is actually built on rivers, you know, there's no shortage of water, but it's become highly polluted during the 18th century. They start to bring in water from outside, so they set up the first water system, bringing water from Malone and piping it into Belfast through wooden pipes, and that is set up by spring water commissioners who were established by the Charitable Society. They also open a new graveyard, which is still, again, still there this day, the Clifton Street Graveyard. It is the Charitable Society which sets up the graveyard which is needed for the town. So they're doing all of that, and so they're quite an important body, and remain quite an important body for some time. As I said, it's a body which is open to everybody in the town to come involved with. The records of Clifton House are in the Hall Library now, although there's a microphone copy in here. Another body which is set up in the 18th century is the ballast board. As I said, Belfast becomes an important trading town, but there are problems with the harbour. It is quite shallow. Belfast is down here. Really, this is slow land. In those days, this is all mud flats. You really don't have sort of deep water until you really get out to what's called the Pool of Garmile, which is actually out opposite Hollywood. Larger ships can only get as far as Garmile, be unloaded and brought into lighters down this very narrow winding channel through the slow land into Belfast. So there was always work to be done improving the access into the actual port of Belfast. And it's worth bearing in mind that, you know, where we're standing today, there's a huge amount of work that's been done to build up and build, you know, to actually build new land and actually change the shape of the town. What you're sitting on at the minute is slob land. This is mud flats. This would be out here. This would be underwater at high tide. The railway line over there, if you come into the train, that is more or less the old coastline. That would be the coastline back in the 18th century. All of this area, stretching all the way down the road, is all mud. It's all been mud flat. It's all reclaimed land. And it's all work largely done by the harbour commissioners, by the successors to this body, the ballast board, which is set up by the merchants in the town to improve the town. And as I say, they eventually become the Belfast Harbour Commissioners, and they do all this work to actually build the new channels, that's now Victoria Channel, Direct Channel, into Belfast. It was done in the middle of the 19th century. All of this land is reclaimed and built up on both sides of the river by the Harbour Commissioners. So they're a very important body. Controlled by the merchants in the town. 1800, there's another body. The town, as I said, is growing. It's probably 19,000. You have all these ad hoc bodies doing various things, but it's still a bit of a mess. Eventually, they set up a new body to do the ministries in the town called the Police Board. Now, they're using the term policing in its older 18th century term. It's not police per se as a uniform police force, it's policing in the wider sense of actually controlling the town and improving the town. The police board was set up to do paving, road repairs, street lighting, to a certain extent to regulate the town, to actually get involved in law and order. They do eventually set up a police force, but they don't do that right away. They do that in, I think it's 1813, they set up a night watch, which eventually becomes the Belfast Town Police. And they're responsible for introducing gas street lighting into the town as well. First gas works are set out, built in the current gas works area in the 1830s, and they start lighting the streets of the town by gas. So this is quite an important body, and it's also important because it's an elected body. It's elected by ratepayers, not elected on a very restricted franchise. Relatively few people could actually vote, but it is an elected body responsible to ratepayers, responsible for improving the town, and so their legacy to a certain extent is the gasworks in the town, is what that is here. You're probably wondering who that guy is, and I'm trying to remember his name. He was the first commander of the Belfast Police Force, Sir Eyre Coote. He later comes on to become the first commander of the London Fire Brigade. He established the first police and fire brigade in Belfast. I don't have his name in my notes here. Anyway, that's just by the way. So that body has been set up as well, and it's doing a lot of work in the city. This makes, as you say, all this makes the old corporation even more relevant. And just say the other thing that the police commissioners could do was raise money by rates. They could charge a rate and raise that money to do the work. So you have a police rate set up. So we have some very interesting early rate books, which nobody's actually looked at very much from a research point of view, which are quite interesting. But they're able to raise quite a bit of money because the town's growing and getting more prosperous. So we're able to raise quite a bit of money to actually do these improvement works. Other body I mentioned in passing, I don't want to get too heavily into it, is the grand jury. Both County Antrim and County Down have a grand jury, which does sort of major infrastructure jobs. So they build the bridge over the Laggan jointly, the old bridge which replaced the ford. So those are two bodies sort of outside the town which have, you know, doing works inside the town. The grand jury also does the jail and the courthouse. So they're an important body whose records are here as well. And you know, just an example of the records that have these resentment books, and to say that's a subject for another day. Yet another body which has emerged in the 1830s is the Board of Guardians. New Poor Law comes in Ireland in 1834. They set up a new system of workhouses. The whole of Ireland is divided up into these unions. Area of Belfast becomes a union. Much bigger area than the town of Belfast, by the way, the Union of Belfast, but it does include the town. A union workhouse is built and guardians are elected. Again, an elected body, elected by ratepayers, elected by the people who pay the payroll rates. They ran the workhouse. Now that's the workhouse, we already had a talk by Dr. Perdue on it, which will be available on our YouTube channel at some stage, if you're interested in that. But just to make a point, that's another elected public body in Belfast. And that's the Belfast workhouse that became the city hospital. However, the main archive which I'm getting to is what's usually known as the Belfast Corporation Archive. What happens is in the 1840s there was a big reform movement in government. Quite a lot of reforms are pushed through. One of the things which they look at the stage is these old corporations which have become very corrupt and very generally considered to be fairly useless. There's a government inquiry in the 1830s, which like many government inquiries had already made its mind up what it was going to do for the inquiry. But they reviewed all the workings of all the town corporations in Ireland and said that most of them were useless. The phrase they used for Belfast Corporation, that it was no longer a body of any interest to the inhabitants of the town. Basically, it was really doing nothing of any use to the town. It was still electing MPs, still electing the two MPs of the Irish Parliament in 1800, and then one MP to the Westminster Parliament down to the Reform Act in 1830. Other than that, it really doesn't have any function whatsoever. So the government eventually abolishes it. In 1842, a new elected town council is established in Belfast in 1842. Now, just by way of confusion, it is Belfast Town Council, then it becomes Belfast City Council, then it becomes Belfast City and County Borough Council, but it is usually known as Belfast Corporation. Those of you old enough to remember, back when it was still going in the 1970s, remember that you always call it Belfast Corporation, which is confusing because then people confuse it with the old corporation. It's a corporation in the sense that it's a corporate body, so that phrase is used, but technically speaking it is a town council and later a city council. So you have an elected city council, elected by ratepayers. Again, it's a fairly restricted franchise, although it does expand later. Initially you have 40 councillors elected. They elect one of their members as mayor. And you have more or less a modern type of local government body. It runs through committees, they pick up the committees, most of the work is actually done by committees. This new body, City Council, is set up. It starts to take over a lot of responsibility from the other bodies. It wasn't actually meant to do that, interestingly enough, but the people who control it by the new elected body are quite ambitious. They buy out the remaining rights of the Donegal family, so they buy the market rights. He still owned the rights to the market and a few other bits and pieces. So they remove Donegal family basically from any sort of position or administration, ministry of authority in the town, about any existing rights, he has. They take over the work of the police commissioners, which I mentioned. They weren't meant to do that, and police commissioners weren't particularly happy about it. It was done in a very dubious manner, but they do it. And so the police commissioners disappear. The corporation takes over their work and their police rate as well, they actually get the money. So they take over those responsibilities as well. And they are responsible for running the town into the late 20th century. And so those are the major landmarks. Comes a city Belfast, comes a city in 1888. Federal Lord Mayor is granted in 92. Comes a county borough in 98, which basically means it takes all the responsibilities from the county council. From that date onwards, basically, all the things the county council will be doing. And culminates with the city hall, you know, in 1906, which is sort of an example of just how he developed the town to come to this stage. It is worth bearing in mind, though, throughout the 19th and 20th centuries, you have your town council, but you also have these other bodies. You have four elected local bodies in Belfast at that period, as well as the town and city council. The harbour commissioners, the ballast board is developing the harbour commissioners. They're still going to this very day. They're still running for Belfast. It's still a sort of public body. It's a Govco now, it's a good government-owned company. But they're still going. They develop the harbour area. Very important body. It is elected, but it's elected on a fairly narrow franchise by these business and property users. You have the Belfast City and District Water Commissioners. The Spring Water Commissioners, I mentioned earlier, set up by the Charitable Society. They develop into the Water Commissioners in the 1840s. They become incorporated. They develop the water supply in Belfast. They build the Seven Valley Reservoir. They build the Woodburn Reservoir. And they're responsible for the water in Belfast and the surrounding area up to 1973. Very important and very powerful body as well. And then you have the Board of Guardians, which is the running the workhouse. And they, believe it or not, are still going until 1948 before they're finally abolished. So you have these bodies, they're elected by people. There's a certain amount of overlap. For instance, the Lord Mayor of Belfast was ex officio, also a harbour commissioner and a water commissioner. And a lot of people are elected to the Board of Guardians, as guardians are also on the council. So there's a certain amount of overlap, but they are separate bodies and often they will come into conflict with each other. The city council does attempt to take over both the harbour commissioners and the water commissioners, but they're fought off by vested interests, so it doesn't work out for them. The new city council is able to do quite a lot of big projects. They're able to raise money. I mentioned the rich earlier on, as an example, reading books. Growing city population expanding throughout the 19th century at a great rate. Population has risen to 71,000 by 1841 and by 380,000 by 1900. So a huge raise in population. Lots more people, but so lots more money being raised through rates. They're also able to borrow money. They're able to take powers to borrow money on the market by issuing bonds against, which are secure on the rates. So they're able to raise very large amounts of capital for capital projects. So they're able to undertake a large range of jobs or projects to improve the city. In their early days, they sort of don't seem that interested in doing anything. So 1845, and the council just been set up, there's a public meeting. The mayor, Andrew Mulholland, talks to the meeting and says, you know, there's lots of things we need to do in the town to improve conditions, particularly improving conditions for the working classes, for operatives. We need amenities such as public parks, public baths, washhouses, free supply of pure water, a library, reading rooms. But he does say, this is not the job of the town council to do this. But he doesn't go on to say whose job it was. And actually it was the town council who took this over and started doing it. And it's the same with the big cities in England. You have this, all the problems which industrialisation, overcrowded cities are bringing to the fore. You've all read your Dickens, you know what conditions are like in the inner cities. Those problems are being addressed by the local councils at a local level. And you have this thing which is sometimes called the municipal gospel, this idea that we must improve the lives of people in the cities and it's local authorities to do that. And it's the same in Belfast. The Belfast Corporation Council has a reputation of being conservative, and politically it was conservative. It was always controlled by conservative stroke unionists. But it took the same attitude to its need to improve the city, the need to improve people's lives, to invest money to improve conditions for everybody. Self-defense to a certain extent, because the city's unhealthy, everybody suffers, the rich and poor alike, when you have infectious diseases, when you have polluted water and all the rest of it. So it's self-defense to a certain extent, but you do have these big campaigns to actually improve the city. And this may be physical improvements. That's a fairly rare photograph of what's now Royal Avenue before the development. That's the bank, which is still there, it's now the Tesco's Express. You notice that that's a very narrow street, it's called Hercules Street. And it's a narrow, sort of winding street, and fairly run down area, the town is the butcher's area. Corporation clears this area in the 1850s, spends a lot of money, buys up the buildings, clears them, and builds Royal Avenue. And it's a big, impressive processional route down through the middle of the town. So they're doing that sort of large-scale infrastructure project. They're also doing a lot of work as well, they're boring work, things like improving public health. A lot of this is to do with things like sewers, putting in. It's not glamorous work, but it's very, very important to actually improving public health. Actually getting a proper system of clean water and sewage removal is probably the most important work in actually improving public health in the town. We're still, you know, we're still working with basically like most big industrial towns, the infrastructure we have in terms of water supply and sewage is basically Victorian. We're still working on the infrastructure that they put down. So they spend a lot of time and money doing that. There's other aspects of public health which they're involved in. Regulation of the markets is another big thing. I mentioned that they bought over the market rights from Lord Donegal. That's very important, improving the standard of food. They take over the slaughterhouses, control the slaughtering of animals, improve the hygiene there, and start regulating there as well. So there's a huge amount of stuff to do with that. Public parks is another thing. You probably don't think of parks as being a public health issue, but they are. There's basically a lack of fresh air in the city. Cities are heavily polluted. Everybody's burning coal in their own homes and also in the factories. And Belfast, again, I'm just a bit old enough to remember this, Belfast did have an issue of smog because of where it is in the valley. The smoke didn't get blown away necessarily, so you probably can remember when you had, before the Clean Air Act came in, you did have a problem with smog in Belfast. And those of you also remember the city hall that was black, and that was the air pollution, you know, so there's not any water breathing in. Parks is quite important to actually provide some oxygen. Belfast isn't that well supplied with parks, but it does have some. And they are basically something which the council develops more or less as a public health initiative. The first park of Belfast is Botanic Garden, which was actually a private one, which the corporation later takes over. Then you have a pleasure garden in Dargan Island, which is just down the road where the shipyard is, when this area was developed. And then there's the People's Park just down the road, which is now Sydenham Park. And then you've other parks like Falls Park being developed by the council. So you do have this number of parks. But again, the emphasis for it is public health as much as recreation. Public baths is another thing. Again, you probably think in terms of public baths in terms of swimming and leisure, but essentially they were literally baths. Very difficult for anybody. A lot of the houses are built without any washing facilities. So again, someone's going to remember that. So a lot of places for working class people, the only place they really have a bath is in a public bath. So public baths are being built around the town by the corporation where you can go in and for you just for a penny get a bath on a Friday night. So that's the one at the bottom of Peter's Hill, actually, not one there. So these are being built around the city, again, as a way of promoting public health rather than actually as a recreation facility. Libraries is another thing. The first three public libraries opened by the corporation in 1870. They built Central Library, beautiful building. The thing with the libraries is it's an opportunity, get books in and improve people's education, but it's also an opportunity that there's around a nice building. So they spent a lot of money on Central Library when it was opened in 1870, to the extent that they ran through the whole budget and couldn't afford to buy any books. So basically it was opened and had a wonderful marble floor, and there was branches there, but there was no books for a long time, and they actually got some money there to buy books. They had an idea that then the whole library would actually give them all their books, because you wouldn't really need two libraries in a town, they reckon, so the whole library would close down and give them the books, but the whole library didn't see it that way. And then you had the community libraries. After maybe the 19th century, he puts up a lot of money, Scottish, he makes a huge amount of money in America, and spends a lot of money for libraries. So we have a community library like the Falls Library here being built in the city as well. So that's another emphasis of the improvement facilities. Gas and electricity, I forgot to mention gas. Belfast Corporation, the gas is set up as a private company. They then get a contract for street lighting. The corporation takes over the gas undertaking and they run it as a sort of way of raising money. It's not only a service between gas lighting the streets and gas people's houses, but they're able to make quite a lot of money out of it, and that money is very useful that money builds the City Hall to a certain extent. It's the property, you know, it's built with the properties from the Gas undertaking. They also developed, started the 20th century, they developed an electricity system as well. It's actually the Gas people who actually, the Gas undertaking, which sets up the electricity system in Belfast. That's the first electricity generating station in Belfast. And I can't remember where that is, eh? Sorry, my mind has gone blank. It's somewhere off Castle Street, but that was the first generator, was actually went in there. It's a photograph taken in 1915. So the corporation is running those services as well, but not only they're doing the services, the point is, but they're actually making money off them. And the third service is the transport. They eventually take over the Belfast Street tramways and electrify them. So that's a very important provision and also a very important source of revenue for the council. So the council in the 20th century is running three big trading utilities, a gas utility, an electricity utility, and the trams and buses. And they're making a huge amount of money from these, which goes in to support the rates and to support projects. So we're able to actually electrify the first electric tram in 1906. Education as well. They don't get involved with schools until the 20th century. The schools were the province of the churches, and the churches sort of resisted any sort of government or local government involvement in schools. Belfast does have a technical education system. There's an art college in Belfast, which the council takes over. Then they opened the Belfast Tech. That opened in 1906, so the University of City Hall. I think it's a very nice building. People use it today, and it's the sitting fundamentally, so you can't see the Methodist, but I think it's an important building in its own right, sorry, not Methodist. I think it's quite a nice building. I don't know, I think it's been turned into a hotel now. I'm sure they're undergoing on the
student apartments.
Student apartments, yeah. It's a lovely building inside, and it was beautifully built and actually per purpose designed as a cottage on the top floor, which is the art college, it was the top level. Anyway, that's another corporation service, is in the short term, or initially, it's just further education, as we would call it, technical education. They don't take over schools until the 1920s, when the New Education Act comes in, and then they become the education authority of the city and build out the cities. And there is the sort of general improvement work, improving back streets, doing away with nuisances, and all the rest of it. An ongoing project, it didn't go as possibly as far as fast as I might have done. Wonderful series of photographs by Robin Hogue, taken 1911, 1912 off the city. After one of the improvement acts, when he goes around and photographs a lot of these areas, it's needed improving, and arguably that street needs improving. So that was, you still have a lot of streets and areas in the city like that, back streets like that. Good for them, just so you just give you an idea of the population. We talk about the city growing. 1911, its population over 400,000 in a fairly restricted area, and smaller. We kind of city than those have now. So a very crowded and a very young city with lots of social problems still. There's papers on all of those issues in the collection. You've also got the papers of the Lord Mayor, I'm sure. That's Crawford McCulloch, a very important Lord Mayor from the early 20th century. The papers of the Lord Mayor are very important. These are very important figures in the development of the city. Particularly in the 20th century, if you're doing any research in the background of the city, it's quite important. Lord Mayors in Belfast are quite important people, obviously. They're big figures, they're generally merchants, they're generally quite wealthy, certainly in the early days. They usually threw their own money around as well. You know, call it paid for, you know, a lot of his own entertainment. You know, he didn't actually get off the council as such. And if you wanted to be Lord Mayor, you would probably put your hand in your pocket. So they tended to be the rich merchants actually got into it. So people like Edward Harland and Perry and people like that were Lord Mayor at various periods. And final word, the Belfast boundary expands over the 19th century. We get a boundary expansion in 1906 and then sticks like that. And during the 20th century, the town expands outside of the boundary. The boundary of the of the city council itself is not expanded, is not increased. That's because the Northern Ireland government from 1921 is a bit wary of Belfast City Council, which they say has been too powerful for the body. So there's a lot of tension between Belfast City Council and Stormont. Although they're both controlled by unionists, they're different unionists. They don't get on each other, so there's a lot of tension. And one of the things that the Northern Ireland government did was make sure Belfast did not get a boundary expansion. So a lot of the town expands outside of Belfast. So if you're looking at the history of Belfast, you have to be aware that a lot of what you may think of as Belfast was outside the town boundary. This area, particularly down here, south and west, and Castlereagh. So you have all these other local authorities. Newton Abbey, in 1960, Newton Abbey is formed under a borough in the north and becomes the third largest town in Northern Ireland, so it's great. You have all this development in Castlereagh down along here. The attempt to make Castlereagh found in the 1960s, which doesn't actually work out, it's resisted. So this area is actually governed by Castlereagh Rural District Council. Hollywood has its own home council, Urban District Council, and then you have this one down here. But these areas out here, three of the rural district councils, are actually running services in this area. So it is quite a complicated picture. So if you're doing any history or research into this, you may find, you know, it's complicated. It's complicated also for the fact that although the, you know, this is outside the boundary, for instance, in this area here, you know, the Belfast Transport buses and trams actually were running this area. They were getting their water from Belfast Water Commission. They're probably getting gas from Belfast Corporation Gas as well. So to a certain extent, they're sort of being drawn into the corporation area, but they're actually outside the boundary and paying a lot less in rates as well. There's no reason why the boundary didn't expand. These people down here just got to pay less rates if they're in this member of the district council. And if they were in city council, they're still getting some of the city services. So that is that. Sorry to bother Robert and run through. The records are here. As the handout will let you the reference numbers you want to do any further research in here. They're very large collections, particularly LA 7 Northwest City Council 9, very rich collections. So I would recommend them to you for further research. Any questions on that?